Good morning. If you can hear me, you can give a holy honk. That'd be great. That's so cool. Just has to replace songs for right now. So glad you guys joined us here in the parking lot. You guys that are on the live stream, welcome.
Now you would bear my cross.
done for me. Father, thank you for that amazing grace, God, and all that you've done for us, all that you've provided, all that you, in the past, all that you're providing for us right now, and the things that you're going to provide in the future. The thing that we're thankful for the most is the saving grace that comes from Jesus Christ, the King, the Lamb that was slain, the one that conquered the grave for our sins and for our salvation. And God, that we might have a message to take to the world that Jesus is alive and that his amazing grace is still in effect and still saving lives today. And God, let that be our message. Let it be proclaimed from our doorsteps and from our mouths loud and clear that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through him. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. In case I didn't tell you before, we are on 103.5. If you can't hear the speakers and you just want to listen on your radio in your car, 103.5 is the station. And just a couple of announcements. First one is that we have leadership meetings this week. On Wednesday, elders meetings at 5:30 and board meeting at 7, and those are going to be on Zoom. That's so fun. And then also coming up this next weekend, this is important, this is kind of new, so we are going to be part of the graduate parade for North Andrew here at Rosenau Christian Church. Our youth ministry team has been working with the school, and they are going to send the graduates around in one big parade to all the communities in the North Andrew area, and this is kind of what we're doing instead of a baccalaureate and senior banquet this year. And so they're going to be coming through our parking lot on their way from Fillmore to Rosendale. And so we're going to line this place, and they're going to have a tunnel that they'll stake through as they come through here. We're also going to be giving them some gifts and a message from Gary Hughes as they come through. So we're really, really excited about that. We hope you guys come out and support them and honk your horns and have signs and stuff. Just, it's been weird for them, and we would just like them to know that we do congratulate and honor them as they graduate this year, and it's different, but we still are encouraged by the next generation coming out and are proud of their accomplishments. So we will be lining up here by 4 o'clock. They're starting in Fillmore at 4, so we want to be in place here by 4 so nobody's driving in the midst of their parade. So we'll have people to help park you and everything once you get in here, and we just hope that's a great time of encouragement for what we're doing. We are going to continue with the drive-in church until the end of May, and then on June 7th, we're planning to get back together inside for breakfast at 9 o'clock, praise God, and then for worship service starting at 10 o'clock on the 7th of June, so really looking forward to that. So glad that this medium is here for us to do right now, but I believe God is bringing the church back into the building to go back out to save, to see people saved in the name of Jesus Christ. So I believe that's happening, and God, thank God for bringing us through the storm that we've been going through. At this time, David Roberts is coming to give our Mother's Day celebration and also our communion devotion for today.
Good morning. Chicks under her wings. How could God reference himself as a protective mother unless he poured his compassionate nature into the mother's heart? The most potent attribute of God's heart is his lavish forgiveness of our sins, black sins, washed in red blood producing robes of white righteousness. Like the mother that deliberately forgets her child's shortcomings, he casts our sins directionally as far as the east is from the west, until sinking to the floor of forgetfulness. Simply stated, he is Father God with a mother's heart, waiting to wipe every tear, sitting up with us through the night, and listening to our troubles, solving them while we are still speaking. The mother's heart is best defined by her unselfish generosity and ongoing, unconditional giving. Thank you to our mothers for letting us feel God's love radiate through you. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we gather here today on your day, Lord, and you allow us to share it with someone you've put before us, Lord, to love us and nurture us and raise us, Father. I give you thanks for mothers and wives and mothers and daughters and mothers. Give you thanks for the whole biblical relationship that you established, Father, and I thank you so much for the relationships that we have with our mothers. Which I was thankful for. Jesus, how's that? I picked up this story from my communion devotion at the cross and on the internet. It's called Jesus and His Mother. It's by Tom Cox. Near the cross of Jesus stood His mother. When Jesus saw His mother there and the disciple whom He loved standing nearby, He said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. In these verses, we see the love that Jesus had for his mother. He made sure that she would be cared for after his death, burial, and resurrection and ascension to heaven. We also see in this scene the love that Jesus had for all mothers, for all fathers, and children too. His love for all humanity is shown in how he provided for our eternal care by dying to pay for our sins. Father God, as we take these emblems today of communion, representing your body and your blood, Lord, that you sacrificed us for us, Father, for our sins. I just pray, Father, that we would recognize you, that we would come to you this morning with humble hearts, confessing our sins, Lord, and remember that without you, there would be no eternal hope. In Jesus' name I pray.
Grace when your heart is on fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and it's wrecking me, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. Another in the waters, holding back the sea. And should I ever need a light, there's a cross that bears the burden. no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I will bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be alone. There is another in the fire, standing next to me. There is another in the waters, holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding, what power set me free? There is a greater that holds nobody, and now that power lives in me. There is another in the fire. There's no other name but the name that is Jesus. He was and still is and will be through it all. So come what may in the space between all the things I've seen and this reckoning. I know I will never be cause I know that's where you'll be. I can see a light in the darkness as the darkness bows to him. I can hear the roar in the heavens as his face between west thin. I can feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison walls cave in. Nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between us. There'll be another in the fire, standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters, holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me, I count the joy come every night, cause I know that's where you'll be. I count the joy come every night, cause I know that's where you'll be. I'll count the joy come every time, cause I know that's where you'll be. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour. We'll shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Whether you're a drive-in here, church, or online, Facebook, thanks for coming this morning. Just a few things we want to go over before we begin this morning. First of all, thank you for your continued faithfulness and giving to Rosendale Christian Church. Ultimately, we know that you're giving to the Lord, but we would encourage you to continue to do that as we're not meeting as a church inside, but there's a few ways you can do that. You can either mail the check in to our church address, 976 Highway 48, Rosendale, or you can drop your offering, your tithes or offerings off here at the church, and you can put them under the doors. Under the door there, and she'll grab that. Or you can go online and grab a way for new online giving. It's our Easy Tithe. You can go on there and fill in your information. And maybe some of you have already used that, and you can continue to give. But thank you for doing that. Also, we want to let you know, if you have any prayer concerns, praises, or anything you want to pray about, you can go on our website, rosendalecc.com, and you can go on to the link that says Prayer Wall, and you can type in whatever prayer. If you want that to be public, you can. If not, you can keep that private. And if you want to ask me to send us to that, we can do that. Just want to know about those few things. We'll begin this morning. So, if you have your Bibles with you, that's a phone, some device, maybe an actual paper Bible. Proverbs 31 is probably the most well-known chapter in the Bible that deals with godly women, wives, and mothers. And I just have a few verses that I want to share with you as we begin this morning. And what amazes me about this chapter is that we don't really even know who wrote this. We think it might have been Bathsheba, Solomon's mother, but she remains anonymous, which I think is just a mark of humility on her part. But she has some great, incredible advice and wisdom for her son. And one of them is how to be a godly king. The other was how to find a virtuous wife, a mother, a godly mother. And so in verse 10, I want to read that for you. Who can find a virtuous wife? For her worth is far above rubies. And go all the way down to verse 28 of the same chapter here. Verse 28, it says, her children rise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is passing, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. So that's why we're here this morning, and of course to worship the Lord and honor Jesus Christ. But our service today is one that honors and praises the mothers. Children, rise up, the Bible says, and husbands are also to praise mothers as well. So Mom, we want to honor you this morning and praise and just recognize how much we appreciate and love you. So it's Happy Mother's Day. And I hope that you do hope to get to spend the privilege of spending the day with your mother, whether that's lunch or whatever that's going to be. Or if your mom's not here, like some of us, my mom's not with us any longer, you're going to recall some fond memories of your mom. And I hope that however you celebrate your Mother's Day today, it's going to be a special one. It's going to be meaningful to you. And I once had an elder many years ago in my first ministry that told me that he believed the highest calling of all human relationships was a mother. And I thought that was very interesting. I didn't really know what to think about it at that time because I kind of thought that probably there might have been some other higher callings. But as I thought about it, I think he's right. Of all the human relationships in the world, I think mothers have the highest calling. Think about that and how much she gives, how much she sacrifices, how much time she gives to her children to nurture and teach, to encourage, to discipline, to offer all for the preparation and the lead them on as young adults. Hers is not the highest authority in human relationships, actually the father is, but she has the highest responsibility. She's probably the most likely to be the one that's going to take the kids than the father is. She has an incredible role and influence to play in the lives of our children. And so it's easy to see why being a mother is the highest calling of all human relationships. When you look back to God's story, his story in the Bible, we see some of the most humble and committed, strongest, wisest, sacrificial, and influential people in God's Word were mothers. We don't need to think that they're just weak, fearful, and vulnerable. They're actually pretty tough. Right, mothers? Agree to that? Yes, you are. We see some of the most brave and courageous and faithful women that God called to be mothers. Let me just mention a few of those for us this morning. We think about Sarah, who was the mother of a promised child, Isaac. We think about Rachel, who actually died in giving birth to her youngest son, Benjamin. Leah, who was blessed to have 6 of the 12 of the tribe of Israel, 6 of those boys, she gave birth to. Hannah, who through her misery and through her prayers to the Lord, constantly asking for a son, finally got a son, and then she gave him back to the Lord. Elizabeth, who was old and barren, but yet God did a miraculous thing in her womb and provided a son who was called John the Baptist. Even in the Gospels, a woman named the Syrophoenician woman, I'm not sure what her name was, but she came to Jesus and asked that Jesus would heal her daughter of a demon possession. She took a risk. And then we have in the New Testament as well, Eunice, who was Timothy's mother, who had invested and poured out her life into her son, who would later become a pastor. And of course, as Dave mentioned this morning, Mary, who's the mother of our Lord, had this awesome responsibility to give birth to Jesus Christ. No doubt some of the most highly called mothers of God throughout all of Scripture. But one mother that caught my attention, I just read that to you from Proverbs 31, was a mother in Proverbs 31, the nameless one, that gave advice to her son, who was a king, also trying to help him understand what to look for, what qualities or attributes to look for in a godly mother, in a godly wife. But today, I'm going to preach this Mother's Day message. Relationships and things in my life to ever get in the way of the gospel, to ever get in the way of God's word. But I want to share with you today a personal message about my own mom and what she meant to me and how the things that she taught and invested in my life. And of course, like you, many of you, you are where you're at today because of your mom and what she's said and did and how she cared for you and loved you. And so this Mother's Day, I just want to share with you some of the principles, the timeless principles that have been, meant so much to me and my two brothers and my sister, and that continue to make a difference in my life. It's true. Proverbs 31:10 says, who can find a virtuous woman? The Bible, in asking that question, they're out there. They're just rare. They're out there, and God has provided them for us. And I feel like my mom, and even I'm so blessed not just to have a mom that is a godly mother, but my wife, Anna, as well. I want to just share with you just a little bit about my mom, just to give her a little background about her life. My mom was born in 1946 in a small town in Illinois, and she was about 80 miles west of Chicago. She was born to a factory worker and a homemaker when they were in their 40s. And she grew up in a kind of a strict home, and with a younger sister, her name's Connie, we call her Aunt C. And she graduated from high school in the same town in 1964, and 2 years later, she married my dad. They would go on to the next few years, in fact, the next 5 years, to have four children, of which I am the oldest. I have two brothers and a younger sister. So it began the journey of motherhood that extended into my adult years. All mothers know that have adult children that are on their own in college or even married with children that continue to be their mom, right? That never stops. That's the way my mom was for me and my brothers and my sister as well. So that extended to 2010. In 2010, my mom went to heaven. It's hard to believe she's gone. She's been gone for nearly 10 years. But she has passed down to me and my brothers and my sister some of the most important virtues of life. And those are ones I want to share with you this morning. And there's going to be five of them. First of all, she worked excellently. She had a great work ethic. My mom grew up in a home, like I said, with a sister, a younger sister. And she had to do a lot of chores. And I know you guys are all familiar with chores and growing up doing them. But she had to do that even at the cost of many times, not being able to spend time with friends on Saturday and getting out and enjoying a lot of the freedoms that a lot of young people have, even though they have chores. My mom wasn't able to do that. She worked hard, and that work ethic went into the rest of her life. She went off to college and studied and did a good job, and she graduated from college. And she would excel in secretarial skills, especially in the legal secretary. I remember her taking me to her law firm where she worked and when I was really young, and I can remember the people. It was a long time ago. I remember the people telling me how much they appreciated her, and her boss, who was the main attorney there at the firm, told me that he just loved my mom and that she was a great secretary, and that she that he hoped he never lost her. Eventually, we would move away, but I can just remember the kind of the affirmation of the people that she worked with and the excellent job that she did when she worked there. My mom was a great worker, and she did that not just in secular jobs, but also in our family. But she knew who she was working for, ultimately. Colossians 3:23 says, not to do work for men, but for the glory of God. And she did that. She not only worked in secular jobs, but when she came home from that job, she had four children to take care of and to mother and to nurture and to discipline at times and those kinds of things. And I don't really know if any mom ever stops working, no matter where they're at, no matter what they're doing when they have children in their lives. And that's a principle that she has invested in me. I know I'm not a mother, obviously, but the work aspect of her life was very important for her to pass that down. And I have two brothers and a sister that also work hard in their jobs and in their life. Number two principle that she passed down to me was she loved passionately. The world has two kinds of people, basically. There are givers and there are takers. My mom was definitely a giver, as most moms are. She went beyond, well beyond her own comfort and her own wants to fulfill the needs of her children. And she did that throughout our whole life. Really, anything that she did it beyond sentiment or words. She loved sacrificially, even beyond even things that she wanted to do. She just gave and gave and gave, and she loved me and my brothers and sister passionately. I remember being my first year of college and away from home and kind of experiencing with all the things that go along with that. I remember her calling me on an actual phone at the end of the hallway. We had two phones in our hallway where I was at a dorm, and that was for long distance calls, remember long distance? She would call and talk to me over the phone and find out how I was doing, and she would also ask me at times, why haven't you called home more? Something that I think mothers tend to do. But she wasn't trying to be pushy, she was just trying to tell me how much she loved me and cared for me. And it was important for her to know, of course, that I was okay. As we got older and went away and got married and had children of our own, my mom took the time, and my dad took the time to go wherever we were. And many times we were far apart in distance. There are times when we were here in the Midwest and they would live in Idaho or Arizona, and they would take the time to come see us and make sacrifices and do all the things they did because they loved us. And they did that for our families, all of us. I remember them taking time to, as many grandparents do, taking time to write birthday cards to all their kids and all their children and their in-laws to show that how much they cared. And they did that for a while up until the end, until things got a little more difficult for them to do that. But I think one of the greatest demonstrations of my mom was that she was a good listener. I remember having conversations with her, but also on it, needed conversations with her, and just willing to listen. She really didn't really want to talk about herself, but she did listen to what you had to say and cared about that and would ask questions. And I just, I think that's something that was so important that my mom showed us in her life. From Philippians 2, it talks about how we are not to merely look at the interests of our own interests, but also the interests of others. And one of the ways that we show love is that we care about other people and we invest in their lives, especially if they're our children. I think those verses really summarize the way that my mom loved. So she worked excellently, she loved passionately, and number three, she served faithfully. My mom actually gave her life to Christ, and that's a testimony in itself later in life. I believe I was in kindergarten or first grade, so she could have been in her late 20s. Or possibly even 30. Christ got a hold of her heart and called her to follow him, and she did. She did that without looking back. Once she set her mind to do something, she did it total, all out, and no holding back. It was great to see her as I watched her in my young adult and adult years, see her grow in her love for God and in the church and ministry. My mom had all of us going to church. Youth groups, camps. We were there on Sunday, Wednesday, or whatever times the church was open. And when it came to church activities, we were there. There were times where we didn't want to go. I know, imagine that. Times kids didn't want to go to church. But that never worked with my mom. We always were going to get in the car, and we were going to be committed to Christ and to his church. And I remember at times when Bob and I would have conversations about our churches and the things that we had going on, how she was so excited to tell me things that they were doing in their churches, whether she was teaching a class or they were very involved in the mission work in the last church that she was a part of down in Arizona. And she was so proud to share about that and also wanted to hear from me and what was going on in the churches that we were pastoring at the time. I have to tell you one story that I appreciate about my mom, probably more than anything in her faith, was that when I was 8 years old, she took me to the pastor who lived in St. Louis, Missouri at the time. And his name was, I still remember this, his name was Charles Wingfield. And she took me to see the pastor because I wanted to be baptized. And so he talked to me and asked me some questions and shared some scripture with me about what it meant to be baptized. And after we were done meeting with him, he told my mom, I don't remember if I was there or if she told me later, but he told me, he said, he's not ready. He's not ready to be baptized. Usually pastors don't tell many people, many kids that. but he told my mom that. And don't worry, it didn't damage my psyche at all, okay? But anyway, my mom was still faithful. We still went to church. We still, you know, read the Bible. We still did the things that we needed to do. But 2 years later, we moved here to St. Joe, and we were attending a small country church, even much smaller than Rosendale. And she took me to the pastor again, because I was 10 at that time, and a much older, much wiser 10-year-old. You know, it was that time that God had put put a calling on my heart to follow his son, Jesus Christ. And at that time, I was baptized. But my mom was faithful in raising us in the church, but also wanting us to know about Christ, also wanting us to be baptized. And she didn't give up on that. And I'm so thankful that that was the story of her life and everything that she did. But her faith was the most important. I believe my mom will hear those words from Matthew 25. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful to a few things. Enter into the joy of your master's happiness. Number four, she lived properly. She lived properly. I remember my sister Julie saying at a memorial service, she wanted to do what was proper. She always wanted to do what was right. I thought that was well put about my mom. It's a great summary of my mom's life. She did want to do what was proper and right and just. And my mom cared about living the way God wanted her to. It meant so much to her that everything was thought out before she did it. That's probably where I get a lot of my, that part of my personality comes from her. So if we don't do things as fast as you'd like to in our church, you know, that's probably why. Okay, because I want to think things out. And I know we need to take a step of faith. My mom also did that. But she just wanted to make sure to do the right thing. I remember reading about a professor at Yale University. His name is Michael Sandel. In the last 2 decades, the last 20 years, his class has been the most popular class in the history of Yale University. The class was a class on justice, how to do the right thing, or how do you do the right things, or how do you determine to do the right things? And thousands of students will come into Sanders Hall at Yale University to talk about, in a Socratic method, with questions and discussion about what is right in the world. And to me, that gives me hope, because my mom always wanted to do what's right, but as we grow further in this world, as history continues to progress into the future, we see less and less of that. But when I hear stories about that, there are people that still want to do the right things. And that was my mom. And I know that's a lot of us that are here this morning. Not just moms, but everybody that is here. Habakkuk 2:4 says, "The just shall live by faith." How do we live a life that's honoring? How do we do what's right? We live by faith. We trust in God. We take him at his word. We believe that he is who he said he was. And he is going to come back one day and get his church. And number five this morning, the principle that she showed me, and I remember this vividly. Of course, I was an older adult. But she died fearlessly. In the late summer of 2010, my mom was experiencing some pretty serious health issues, some medical issues, and eventually the doctors told her that she had cancer, and there was really nothing more that they could do, and it was pretty serious. Some of you may remember this. I traveled back and forth for several weeks to go see my mom in Iowa City at the main hospital, and then in Tibetendorf, Iowa, where she was staying with my sister. But I was in the living room with my mom. Was okay, but she was not reacting very well to medicine. But I remember a conversation I had with her, and I believe she was lucid enough to tell me, because she knew it was coming to the end. She knew the time was getting closer, and she said, "Ken, I'm not afraid to die." And that was reassuring to me, but I think it was more probably reassuring to her that she said that, and she knew that she... My mom was a believer. She loved Christ. She knew who Christ was. She knew where she was going to go when she died. She knew that her spirit's going to be in heaven with him. Her body's going to be laid to rest, but one day that he would come back and she would get a resurrected body free of cancer. And the last memory I had of my mom in conversation, because the last several weeks leading up to her passing, she didn't talk at all. So that's probably one of the most comforting and reassuring things that I heard my mom say. I want to close this morning. I know not all of you here are mothers. Some of you are, and we praise God for you, and we pray that you're honored and blessed this morning, and we pray that you will take the role of your motherhood seriously, to invest and pour your life into your children, because what you do in their life now is going to make a difference for the rest of their life. It really will. The seeds that you plant, the words, the actions, the example that you give makes such a tremendous difference. And I say that as encouragement to you moms, that we all kind of join together and make that recommitment today to do that. But I want to ask you a question as we close this morning, and that is this. What kind of life do you want to be remembered for? There's two kinds of life, they say. There was a guy that wrote a book many years ago. It's called A Road to Character. And he said, there's two kinds of life we can live. We can either live a eulogy life or we can live a resume life. We can live a eulogy life or a resume life. A eulogy life is the character traits that you want to be remembered. You'll be remembered for at your funeral, at your memorial service. Or you can choose to live a resume life, which are those skills and those accomplishments that you did while you were here on the earth, and that the society they applaud it. They say, way to go, that's great, and you have a resume life. I think we all know that are here today, if you're a Christian, you know that what kind of life you want to have is a eulogy life, right? You want to live a life of character, of honesty, of integrity, of compassion. You want to work hard. You want to be good to other people. You want to have a life that's remembered in the most positive way. Not a resume life, because those things that you accomplish, those skills that you have, those jobs that you have, those that money that you make, it's all temporary. But the life of a character that you show to people, that your words back up your life, is going to be invested in the hearts and souls. They're going to remember that. Your kids are going to remember that. Your grandkids are going to remember that. That's why I'm sharing this with you today, because I remember, I'm 53 years old, and I remember growing up with a mom that loved the Lord and tried to do her best to raise me in the Lord as well. So that's my challenge, that's my encouragement to you this morning. Let's pray, and then Rich is going to come and lead us in a song. Father, thank you for our moms today. We are blessed to have them. We know they have such an incredible job and such a big responsibility. We're thankful that they're faithful to that, that they're committed to you, God, first of all, and to their kids, and that they are making a difference. And Father, I pray that this day is a blessing for them. It's honoring them. It's a day that hopefully they can rest a little bit and not have to do the work, that we can do that today, that we can support them and we can encourage them. Father, thank you most of all for your son Jesus, who came and paid the price for our sin, who loves us so much that he, as our bridegroom, as our shepherd, loves us and wants to be in a relationship. Father, thank you for the gospel. Thank you for the good news of salvation and eternal life through Jesus. And in his name we pray. Amen.
Yeah.